a diploma in urban and regional planning from the University of the Philippines, Diliman, and PhD in public administration from the Cebu Normal University. Later on, he took up a postgraduate course in Cebuano language, history, and culture at the USC, University of San Carlos. His passion for culture and heritage is reflected in the two books that he has authored and published under the University of San Carlos Press. The first one was Handumanan, the Rosita Rodriguez Arsenas Collection of Pisayan Santos. And the most recent one is Bantayan, Passion, Devotion, Tradition. He is currently with the Cultural and Historical Affairs Commission of Cebu City as one of its commissioners. And he is also the chairman of the Guadalupe de Cebu Development Foundation. And he is a member of the Project Finance Committee of the Cebu Metropolitan Cathedral. Aside from all of these, he is a collector of fine arts and church art, and a writer and lecturer on the subjects of church art, history, and heritage. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to introduce to you Clodoveo Vicente Luwin Acorda Igachapino. A round of applause for him.
Thank you, Fleur. Good afternoon and welcome to this lecture. I'm very happy to see that we are full house. SRO Saluyo. For the sake of our brothers and sisters in Luzon, I would like to ask everybody to let's use a common language, which is English, because this is being streamed live on Facebook, and my TV is, and also the House Comm Department of Casa Gorordo is videotaping this for uploading later on YouTube. But we are live on FTV through the Cebu Daily News official Facebook. So during our Q&A, let's just agree to use one language. English, okay? At this point, I'd like to welcome, I'm very happy to see that we are honored with the presence of parish priests in from the different parishes in Cebu. I saw Father Tata Torres from Gindaruhan in Miglanilla. Father Tata, gone out there. Thank you for coming. And also, I see Father Sherwin Ferrater of the St. Joseph's Academy in Mandawi. Monsignor of Qatar, is he already here? Wala pa? Yeah. I'd like to acknowledge also the PPC members of the different parishes. I see quite a big bunch of the Recoletos Parish here in Cebu. And we have as far as Parili. Parili? Madam Base, the company, and Balamban, I am really very happy, you know, that you are all here. And also the teachers that we have, Christian formation teachers. Well, let's talk about just 10 important topics about the Pasos, okay? As earlier said, just write down your questions and we will try to answer them after the lecture proper. So let's now start with the definition of what we call pasos, no? Well, it's just a Spanish word meaning step, or if you pluralized it, you put an S, so it becomes pasos. So it simply means, in the Catholic usage, the Spanish Catholic usage, it simply means an event or a step in the life of our Lord Jesus Christ. No? Not specifically about the passion alone, but the whole life of our Lord. No? But here in our country, when we say pasos, the usage refers to basically the Lenten images, which is all right. In Spain, they start their pasos from the baptism of Jesus, which is the beginning of his public life anyway. So all the major events from the baptism unto the resurrection of our Lord, these are all called pasos, okay? And then, it's not all about Christ only, although pasos are Christocentric, the main attraction is always the image of the Lord, there are co-stars. And this is led by the Blessed Virgin Mary as a Lady of Sorrows. And then you have the apostles. You have the women disciples. There are so many of them. And of course, there is a protagonist. Also, we have the images of Pontius Pilate and his wife, Claudia. Why am I mentioning this? It's important because later on we would know that outside of the Catholic Church, this couple is venerated as saints, which we do not. It's very important that we know what is our, or who are our saints and who are not. Okay, solitary images. A paso is not always a tableau. When we say tableau, a French word meaning a group, no? How do we call it? Like a diorama. Single images are also considered paso because that particular image has a connection to the life of our Lord Jesus Christ. So you can see we can have a paso of Our Lady of Sorrows, a paso of Saint Peter, and all that. And then maybe this is too obvious, but still for the young ones especially, what is a carroza? Okay, I see different spellings of this in Facebook. There is a K, there is an S. So we have here the right spelling. Again, it's a Spanish word. It simply means a wheeled carriage used for processing holy images. And this is the right spelling. It is not with a K and it is not with an S. It's always with a Z. It has a double R. So you dribble the R in your mouth, say carroza. That's how the Spaniards would pronounce it. And then what is the difference between a carroza and an andas? An andas is a palanquin. It's carried on the shoulders. Okay. In the olden times, all the pasos are, as an act of penance, all the pasos are carried by an andas. In modern times, it's now difficult to find people who are that devout, no? But you'll be happy to know that until today, in Spain, in Seville, particularly, the costaleros are the ones who carry. There is no carroza in Spain, but only they have huge andas, as much as 60 people under. It's part of their tradition and penance. And for the ladies, Antonio Banderas still goes home to his native Malaga to fulfill his promise to be a costalero. Costalero is what we call mamamasan. In our language, no? In Spain, they're called costaleros, and they take it very seriously. And the most famous costalero of all is Antonio Banderas, who has kept his faith despite being a Hollywood superstar. Now, you've also often heard about this term, camarero or camareras. Yes? We often hear about this, and we really don't know what is a camarero, what is a camarera. Okay, so briefly defined, these are devout men or women who have been entrusted to care for a particular image. Okay? Camarero is the Spanish equivalent of the English chamberlain. The concept of chamberlain is one who manages the affairs of a noble person or a monarch, no? So in English, camarera would be lady-in-waiting. But usually, it's really a male-dominated world, camarero. But until now, we have a Lord Chamberlain to the Queen in England. So he takes care of the personal matters running the household of the Queen, for example. Queen Elizabeth, who has about, 2,000 servants under her payroll. So the Queen cannot attend to this, so there has to be somebody to manage that. Now, in the Santo world, the camarero is the one who takes charge of the image of the Santo or the Santa, or worst, a tableau, which can have as many as 13 to 15 persons in a carriage or in an andas. Next. Okay, I've been using this word. Maybe it's time to define it. It's a French word. Tableau singular, tableau plural, but you write it with an X. And that is something wrong with the French language. They use a lot of letters and they don't use it anyway. You'll only see the difference between the singular and the plural in most French words if you see it spelled. So if it is with an X, that means it's plural. And without an X, singular, but they're both pronounced the same. And then, paso de misterio. We have to distinguish between a singular solitary paso and when we have a tableau. When it is already a tableau, the Spaniards would call it paso de misterio. And then followed by whatever the tableau represents. No? For example, the house. This house, Casa Gorondo, owns a paso de misterio de segunda caída, which we will see later on. So paso de misterio, that's the formal way of saying it. Don't just say paso de la caída. That's quite off. Okay, paso de misterio, if it's a tableau. But if it is singular, say an image of the Blessed Virgin or any other apostle or disciple, just paso de, and then the name of the saint. And then judío. This is not very common. This is not usually used in Luzon area. Maybe some provinces, no? But here in the Visayas, especially in Cebu, this is a very common term. And it refers to a very bad person. No? Even the Roman soldiers here in our country is called a judío. When in fact, the term judío means a Jew. In Spain, they do the same. They actually taught us how to hate the Jews so much that they use the term judío to refer to all those who inflicted suffering on Jesus, even if they were in fact Roman soldiers. Finally, for our definition of terms, another commonly misunderstood word is the calandra. Okay? On Good Friday, we have the procession of the burial of our Lord. And the image of the dead Christ is usually put in an aquarium-like carroza with all the attendant angels and flowers. Now, technically, that is called a calandra. And in English, it is a funerary bier which carries the coffin of a dead person. No? So, you've learned today the meaning of calandra. So you do not just say kanakba, kanakba. You say calandra, you use the term. Let's get used to it, no? There is calandra, specifically. You only use that for the image of the dead Christ. There are calandras that are movable, like the one I saw in Mabolo yesterday. So they can have the image of the dead Christ venerated all year round, and then the wheel portion, the lower portion, is kept in the bodega that can be used also for other procession or images for procession, which is quite neat. No? In the cathedral, for example, it's fixed. So the whole thing is just used once a year on a Good Friday. So after the definition of term, let's go to the history. Okay? It's very important. When did this devotion start? Okay, well, there is no record. And if you will check the history of the religious orders, the Augustinians came first to Christianize us, and then the Franciscans, etc. It was the last group of Spanish friars that is on record or is recorded to have brought the first Paso image in 1606. The Recollects came here in 1606. They first landed in Cebu, May 12. And then they stayed for a while with the Augustinians before they proceeded to Manila. So they arrived in Manila May 31, 1606, until they built their own house in Intramuros. And this Paso of the Recollect is the famous, it's extant, no? It's still venerated now, highly venerated by our brothers and sisters in Manila especially. It's the image of the Nazareno, or formally, the image of the Nuestro Padre Jesus Nazareno, our Father Jesus of Nazareth. It's still there. 1606. So you can consider that as the first ever Paso. Earlier today, I have a Dominican friend who said, No, it's not right because their image of Our Lady of Solitude was ahead by 3 years because it arrived 1603. But I'm not sure about that. I have to check the data myself, no? But the 1606 is established. So maybe we can say, okay, the two first pasos that arrived in the country that is recorded is that of the Nuestro Padre Jesus Nazareno and the Virgen de la Soledad. Nuestro Padre Jesus Nazareno of the Recollects and the Virgen de la Soledad of the Dominicans. The Franciscans are actually the order that is dedicated or devoted to the Passion of Christ. As a matter of fact, those of you who have been to Jerusalem, you'll notice that the holy sites are under the care of the Franciscans that was given to them because of Saint Francis. But they did not immediately introduce the devotion to the Passion here in our country. It was actually the Recollects, by default or intentionally, that started it with the arrival of the Nazareno. And old records in Intramuros, their famous pasos are the main attraction for Palm Sunday. They hold their procession on Palm Sunday in Intramuros. And these are the Recollects, and very few. They have the Agony in the Garden, the Scourging at the Pillar, the Crowning of Thorns, which is otherwise known as Nuestro Señor Jesús de Paciencia, Our Lord Jesus of Patience, and then the Nazareno. Okay? Much, much later, the Dominicans with their ivory pasos took over the popularity, but for the record, the Recollects started the devotion. Okay? And this is the image, contemporary photo of the Nuestro Padre Jesus Nazareno. It is from Mexico. It is made of hardwood, and it is sculpted in 6 feet scale. Monsignor Ramirez, when he was rector of the Basilica of Quiapo, gave me a used vestment of the Señor, and once I tried to fit it, and it fit. So he's as big as I am, no? Although I'm not quite 6 feet yet, but bigger. It's still there. If here in Cebu we have the Santo Niño as our focus of intense Friday devotion, our brothers and sisters in Manila, in Luzon, have the Nazareno in Quiapo. Thank God it survived so many wars, no? Now you might ask, why was it transferred from Intramuros, the Recollect Church in Intramuros, to the Franciscan Church in Quiapo? It's a long story, but church politics had something to do with the transfer. It was decided by no less than the Bishop of Manila, who practically took it out from the Recollects Church in Intramuros and gave it to the Franciscans in Quiapo, 1776, thereabouts. Next. So from the two first images, let's give credit to the Dominicans because they might be watching this, and I'm a Tomasian, they might not forgive me for not including the Virgen de Soledad, which they claim is 1603. So the two images from there, we do not know, but it spread. Okay, it became a popular devotion in the country. So by the 18th and 19th centuries, pasos have become a mainstay in our parishes. Okay, 19th century, here in Cebu, in 1860 to be exact, Cebu was open to international trade. No longer do the imports and our exports have to pass through Manila. We dealt directly with Europe. And this is probably the time that the Spanish pasos, such as what we will see later, owned by the house, came from. No? And if you've been inside Casa Gorordo, the house museum, there are so many furnitures there that were called the rigor furnitures of the rich at the time, which was imported directly from Europe because importation became easy. We had direct access to international market already starting in 1860. So the proliferation of beautiful pasos from Spain must have started this during this period. However, Manila is Luzon. Is not to be left undone, no? Until now, the pasos of Binyang, Laguna, Paite, Laguna, and even Makati, they still hold on to the centuries old. If you'll ask me which is the most impressive, I should say the one in Makati, because I've seen a 6-foot image of Señor Cautivo, the moment when Christ was arrested in the garden, and it had ivory head, ivory hands, and ivory feet. And the owners make sure that the feet are shown by cutting short the garment, so the feet, the ivory feet, would be shown. No? I've never seen anything like that anywhere else. Although Santo Domingo claims that the Santo Sepulcro also have the same. It's all covered in cloth. You only see the face. Yes, it's ivory, but the hands and the feet you do not see anymore. But that one of Makati, I don't know who the owner is. The Cristo has blue eyes and ivory head, hands and feet. Quite unusual and quite expensive even during that time. Okay, now we go to practices. Different parishes have different Paso practices. I don't know if there is a parish here in Cebu. I'm not sure. I introduced this to Guadalupe during the time of Monsignor Puno, and we gathered a lot of people. We decided to have our Paso procession on Palm Sunday because Guadalupe is already an urban barangay. So people are busy working. In the rural areas, you might want to have your Paso any day of the Holy Week. But I understand now, as far as Palamban, which is fast being an industrialized town, they also stop their Paso procession. No? Same with Guadalupe. What they do now, and same with Punta, another urban, the Archdiocesan Shrine of Our Lady of Guadalupe, they now just have one grand procession on Good Friday. And you cannot blame them because my friend from Palamban told me that they have about 40 carrozas and about half that number of people who would join in their used to be Holy Tuesday procession. So they decided to stop that practice anyway and just put it all in one big grand Good Friday procession where they all come. No, the only ones that kept their Paso separate is, I think, Carcar and Barili. Still have it Barili, no? Mercolis Santo. And Bantayan, of course. They still do it on a Holy Thursday. The first Paso, the one that is before Good Friday, strictly speaking, that is the one that covers the life event of our Lord. So you might want to have a baptism of the Lord, if you so wish. But the more important would be the five sorrowful mysteries. Any parish who has this, you're good. Because after all, we're so familiar with the five sorrowful mysteries. We pray it twice weekly. We pray it on Tuesday and Friday. So these are the main events in the Passion of the Lord. But the fifth mystery is not to be processed before Good Friday. Okay? You can choose Palm Sunday, Holy Monday, Holy Tuesday, Holy Wednesday, even Holy Thursday, like in Bantayan, for pastoral reasons, but without the crucifixion or the Calvario scene. That is processed only on Good Friday. So on Good Friday procession, usually, it's the Calvario that follows the image of St. Peter, and then you have the solitary images, and the finale is the image of the dead Christ or the Santo Sepulcro. The second procession, the second procession is what we call the burial procession, which is done on Good Friday. Okay. Usually, the only tableau allowed in this procession would be the Calvary, because it's proper to the day, and the Pietà. These two tableau, no? And then the rest are solitary images of the women disciples and the few men disciples. Yeah? Okay. Thank you. And then it ends with the dead Christ. Now I understand there's a parish here in Cebu whose parish priest decided to reverse the order and puts the Santo Entierro as the first entry, so that everybody is there And the last one is St. John the Baptist, and only the owner of the carroza and the household help, because according to him, he wants to be historically correct. Well, maybe he has a point, but we're not basically talking of history. We're talking of devotion, diba? And we are allowed excuses. Of course, he is correct. We cannot find a burial where the dead body is at the last, no? People follow the... But that is today. And besides, the paso is just a representation. We don't have to take it literally. So poor St. John the Baptist, and the owner wants to quit already. I actually ask him, if you want to give me the image, I'll accept it, because nobody is there anymore except him. And his household helped to pull the carro, poor St. John. But anyway, let us remember one thing, the parish priest, and I'm glad we have some priests with us here, the parish priest is always the chief liturgist of a parish. Okay? Even if we have a dissenting opinion or a differing opinion, or even if we think that the parish priest is not listening to us, well, we cannot do anything. Because the parish priest is the chief liturgist of the parish. But of course, you can always appeal to the bishop if the parish priest will not listen to you. Like one parish here who wanted to change the male apostles to female apostles, and fortunately, the bishop, he's a feminist. Why only male? So he changed half of the 12 to 6, which is inappropriate, no, for me personally. So fortunately, the bishop got wind of it, and the chairman of the Commission on Worship called his attention right in the nick of time. Holy Thursday morning, before the ceremonies, the women were already prepared. I mean, and he was saying, the parish priest said, but Pope Francis did that. Yes, Pope Francis did that, but not on a Holy Thursday Mass. But when he visited the prisoner, the women's prison, the women prisons in Rome. And of course, he is the Pope. He can create his own liturgy. We are parish priests, or they are parish priests, they're not free to do that, no? So fortunately for that parish, the scandal was prevented, because it could be very scandalous if there would be a parish priest who would insist on changing all the females or the males into females for the sake of what? Popularity? I mean, historically, women have always played an important role in the life of Christ, as we would see later on. But we all have our specific role in the body of Christ, di ba? We don't have to be women priests, no such thing, or women deacons, no such thing. Only male deacons, male priests, and male bishops. Formatively, the Anglican Church, as soon as they started ordaining women priests, a lot of their members, priests and laity, Anglican Church, you're familiar with the Anglican Church? This is the Church of England. This is the church that has a local counterpart, our own IFI, or Iglesia Filipina Independiente. They severed the relationship with Rome, and in the case of England, whoever is the monarch is their pope. It was started by Henry VIII because he wanted to legalize his marriage to Anne Boleyn while he was yet very much married to Catherine of Aragon. And so he decided, okay, you won't allow me to divorce Catherine of Aragon and marry Anne Boleyn. I declare myself the Pope of England. So that's how it came to be. And they became the English Church, or what you call the Anglican. Anyway, as soon as they started ordaining women deacons and priestesses, a lot of their members came back to the Roman Catholic Church. Because there was no tradition of the Lord ordaining women, no? But the Lord did not denigrate women. The Lord had a lot of women followers. And if you notice the biblical account, only two apostles remain, Peter and John. The 10 ran away from the Lord for fear of their lives. Only the women stayed behind. John and Peter. John and, yes, John. Yeah. And the 10 ran away. Of course, at that time, Judas was no longer there, and Matthias was not yet elected. But the women stayed, the brave women, disciples. So, we welcome the parish priest of Karkal. Thank you very much, Monsignor Puno, for coming. It's very important that parish priest should hear this, because the parish priest has the final say on all of these things. The parish priest, I'm just summarizing because you came late. The parish priest is the chief liturgist, okay? Whether we agree with them or not, sorry na lang, but we have to follow them. But in the case of another parish here, you can always appeal to the bishop if you see that it's really foul already. But small matters, the parish priest decides. The parish priest decides whether this particular saint should be included in the processional lineup or not. You see, lately, there has been a lot of people, especially among the young ones, which is good, that wants to have their own image. But you can only have so much disciples. Now, to bring out people, and especially if they are venerated in the non-Catholic church, a particular example is Saint Susanna. In the Orthodox Church, she is venerated as one of the male bearers, no? Mere bearers of Christ. But I have done my research on her. The only Saint Susanna that the Catholics, the Roman Catholics, venerate is a 6th century virgin and martyr. So there is no Saint Susanna of the 1st century. But some parishes here, in Cebu even, they have Saint Susanna. I said, who is she? I mean, unless you become Orthodox, you're not supposed to venerate a non-Roman Catholic church, right? So let the Orthodox have their lineup, but we have to stick to our lineup. Because if the parish priest will not stop this practice, then you have the seed already of heresy. Later on, you'll have the Church of Saint Susanna there. So what do you do with that? That is the start of heresy. Always disobedience and pride. These are the two seeds that would feed heresy. And do not forget that in the past 21 conciliar meetings of the church, the leaders of heresies are usually bishops, unfortunately. So these are historical realities we have to live with. But for as long as we can, we have to follow and support a parish priest. The parish priest says, there is no such thing as Saint Susanna, which in fact there is none. Then we have to follow. And then if you have an image of Saint Susanna that you have carved and dressed like a mannequin or a Barbie doll, then better convert that to another image of a saint. It's allowed. You can have it rededicated, no? Okay. So where are we now? So, after the Good Friday procession on Good Friday, we have the final paso, which we call the Salubong or the Sugat on Easter Dawn. Okay? So these are the three paso processions of our Holy Week. We have the pasos, Paso del Misterios, except the crucifixion. And then we have the burial procession. And finally, we have the Easter encuentro or salubong in Tagalog or sugat in Cebuano. And in the sugat, in the cathedral, for example, where I am in charge of all this paso preparation, we include the women disciples, as many as would come. No? And we have, of course, St. John and St. Peter. But for the Salubong procession in the cathedral, we have St. Mary Magdalene, St. Mary Magdalene, you have all the other Marys. Yes, because, well, it was the women, this is what I mean. There is a place for everyone in the church. Ladies, just don't ask to be ordained, because that is not ours. I mean, if you want to be ordained, then you better go to England and you have Queen Elizabeth as your Pope. And you are cut off from the body of Christ. Okay. So, there's another Paso procession which is not very popular anymore. Because this observation was actually taken after the Roman calendar general reform of 1969, the celebration of the Viernes de los Dolores. This is dedicated to Our Lady. Exactly 1 week before Good Friday, when the focus is all on the Passion of Christ, the week before that, in the old calendar, we reserve that to commemorate the sorrows of Mary. And popularly, it's called Viernes de Dolores. I think right now, it's only Balamban. The people from Balamban here, Mion, not yet. But really, you still have that. Praise the Lord. Mandawi also. Oh, beautiful Paso. Beautiful, beautiful Dolorosa. The best Dolorosa I've seen in Cebu. It's made of ivory head and hands, and even the heart is ivory. I'm glad Mandawi has kept that, no? Other churches don't anymore celebrate this. But I'm glad that it was never abrogated. It was reformed, it was removed, but it doesn't mean that it has been invalidated or declared illegal. No. It goes on. It's just not anymore of universal character. And I like that. There are two possible representations. You have either the solitary image of Our Lady of Sorrows for the Viernes Dolores, or you can have the tableau of La Despedida. It's not very popular here in the South, but in Luzon, it's quite a popular tableau. I've seen old images of La Despedida. It's a very poignant one. Sometimes the mother and son are embraced. Sometimes they are looking at each other. This is the scene when Jesus is saying goodbye to Mary in Nazareth because he was going to go to Jerusalem. And then you have, on Palm Sunday, you have the triumphant entry into Jerusalem na. But the Friday before the Palm Sunday, this is the time to commemorate the sorrows of Mary. Because when Palm Sunday comes, the Blessed Virgin is already relegated to the background. Why? Because the focus is now on Christ. That's the reason. So I hope other parishes will continue to do it. And if you don't have it, your parishes, that's a good practice. You delineate. The Friday before Good Friday is for Our Lady. And then Good Friday and the week after that is, of course, centered on the Lord. In the olden times, the Viernes Dolores, for very pious and devout people, also starts the beginning of the penance period. No, they no longer eat, they abstain. Some of them start fasting until Easter Sunday. But of course, that's not required. We are only required to do fasting on Ash Wednesday and Good Friday. Okay, that's our fasting. And then of course, all the Fridays of Lent are abstinent, but some very devout people, especially the camareros of the sacred images, they start fasting on Viernes de Dolores haba, no? Until Easter Sunday. Thank God, I do not have it. Otherwise, I'd lose half of my weight. But anyway, so let's next. Okay. Well, the processions, the date of the processions actually depends on the PPC and the parish priest, as always, as the head. They decide what is the best for their community. As I said, for urban communities, like here in Punta and Guadalupe, they stopped doing the Pasos already. They just do one big grand procession on Good Friday because very few people. Why? Because it's a working week until Holy Thursday. So Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Monsignor Puno, during our time in Guadalupe, we had it on a Sunday and we always have a lot of attendees, but I don't know, they stopped it. They moved it back to Wednesday after you left. And nobody attends because it's a working week. I mean, the reason why Monsignor Puno and I, in our Guadalupe days, moved it on a Palm Sunday is because Guadalupe is an urban barangay. So the parish priest and the parish pastoral council and the camareros should agree what is best for the community, not is what is best for one person or what is the whim of the parish priest or whatever. It has to be a communal decision, what day, or because we are already in the urban we're already in urban barangay, maybe we can just have one grand procession on Good Friday. And there's nothing wrong with that. Okay, now Balamban, is the representative from Balamban here? Not yet. Now Balamban, because they do not anymore do their procession on, they have one big grand procession on Friday. What they do is starting on Palm Sunday, they display their pasos. They have a plaza there, they put up tents, and then they display. For this year, I think they have no less than Archbishop Palma, who will bless, because timing, the local World Youth Day will be held in Balamban. So they took advantage. It's a Palm Sunday morning, so the opening, they usually open on Palm Sunday, and then the Lord Archbishop of Cebu will be the one to open the Balamban Pasos. No? And they've grown, and they're growing every year. More and more people are interested to have a devotion to the Passion of our Lord. I saw that in Balamban from about 10 to 12 pasos 20 years ago. They're now up to more than 40. Okay, next. Okay, these are some photos. We have the Jesus de Paciencia, which doubles up as an image of the crowning with thorns. No? This is a tableau owned by the Sosa family of Cebu. And it has two or three judios surrounding it, but we focus the photo on the Cristo. Okay? And on the right, you have the Paso de Misterio de Columna, or Jesus de Columna, the scourging of the pillar in English. And you can see the Lord is alternately being whipped by two judios again. Although, in fact, they're Roman soldiers. Next. Ah, okay. The Santa Veronica of this house, which, as Heidi said earlier, is displayed at the top. No, it could not enter here. It would have been nice here, but the arches are too low. Okay. Santa Veronica of Casa Gorordo. And then the other one is the Jesus Cautivo, or the arrest of Jesus. That's a three person tableau. There is Judas that is covered by the judio or the Roman soldier there, and there is Christ. The image of Judas is about to kiss the Lord, no? But it's placed like that. This is owned by the Royo family, and it's processed in the cathedral on Holy Tuesday. Next. Okay. Why do we have pasos? Yan. We should be able to answer this. I've seen a lot of comments on Facebook. There are some people who seem to have turned the paso ownership into a status symbol. And it is sad. It's not happening here in Cebu yet. But I'm sure it will in a few years' time. I mean, first and foremost, a paso is an expression of devotion. No? The reason why you have pasos, especially processions, because one, we want to manifest our faith. That's how we design religious procession, di ba? And two, we want to express our personal devotion. And sad to say, this is not always true, especially for the young ones, the rich young ones. Nagdagan pa natin, the rich and bored young ones. Okay? Just because they have all the money, and they turn their paso into a status symbol. And it defeats the purpose of having a paso. Okay. The pasos are meant to instill in our hearts the price of our redemption. That's why some of them can be very gory. You see a lot of blood coming from Christ. You see a lot of tears from the women disciples, especially the Blessed Mother. Why? Because it is supposed to, how do I say it, to wake up and, you know, realize how much God loves us. Okay? And He loves us even if we don't love Him back. Finally, the church encourages these popular devotions, as we call them, because hopefully the faith, our faith, will be strengthened by this audiovisual or visual representations, no? As in the years past, the use of images in the church is meant to facilitate the appreciation and the learning. Because it's really difficult to imagine if you just read and then you don't have a visual aid to help you, how Christ was tortured, who did it, and for why, no? So the bloodier the image of Christ, the better to jolt us from our sinfulness. By the way, the Roman penalty for public disturbance, which was what Pilate charged Christ at first, is 40 minus 1 lashes. So expect a really bloody, bloody thing. Those of you who have seen The Passion of the Christ, that is fairly accurate. I counted it. It's really 39. And that is in accord with Roman law. It's actually 40, but less one, they call it an act of mercy. And yet, at 39, the person is almost dead for loss of blood. And, you know, the Roman flagrum is a very cruel instrument of torture. The Roman flagrum, 9 whips, and at certain distances, they are tied with shells, broken glass, or twisted iron. And there are 9 of these. And remember, you are stripped naked, and 39 lash. Yes, except the thoracic part, so that you will not have a heart attack, because you are supposed to die on the cross. That's the reason why on the third fall, the Romans, seeing that the prisoner was already very weak, they had to appoint Simon of Cyrene forcibly to help the prisoner carry the cross. Because if the prisoner dies before he is crucified, then those in custody would be penalized. That's the reason. Not because they took pity on the Christ. They were afraid for the possible sanctions that would be given to them by their superiors. So, let me repeat the purpose of the passage, no? It's really meant to instill in our minds, in the eyes of our hearts, the hardship that Christ suffered for us. That is the purpose. To have a paso is to have a devotion to the passion, the death, and the suffering of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is not to have an image and become a status symbol for the paso. Next. Okay. Now let's go to the kaidas. I'm sure you know, those of you who are devoted to the Stations of the Cross, that the Lord Jesus fell 3 times, di ba? The Stations of the Cross, the 3rd station, the 7th and the 9th, I think, or the 6th and the 9th. So you have the Primera Caída, or the first fall. Caída in Spanish for fall. Okay? It's also a part of a house. It's the... Yes, caída. It's the... it's a step. No. Staircase, typical, like here. You go up one flight of stairs, and then there's a landing. That is the caída. And then you move up one stairs. And according to my readings, the reason why it's called caída or fall, because women at the time who wear very long skirts, that is the area where they let drop the tail of their skirts. Kasi limpyo na. Limpyo na ang balay ba? So, they tuck it in their waist when they're outside of the house. Coming back to the house, or when they attend a party, that's the point when they let it drop, because it's already clean. So, imagine the women of the Gorordos washing with their long skirts in this area here, through that area. Some of them might be here, seated beside you. So, don't be sleepy. If you notice somebody strange looking there, then that might be one of them, okay? Listening to this lecture. Okay. So, as always, the procession before the burial procession, the caída is always the what we call the festejada, or the most celebrated tableau or image. And in social usage, or social expression, especially during the Spanish time, the tableau or the kaida is always entrusted to the richest family and also to the most devout family. So remember that a bishop lived in this house, no? A son of the house. So it is automatically the kaida is given to them. And thank God that even now we still have the kaida of the Gonorlo family. I have a picture of them. I was hoping it would be set up here, but it's so difficult to. It is a 7-piece life-size tableau. It's quite difficult to bring the carosa here. It would not fit. But anyway, there are three. No? The first, the second, and the third. And the most grandiose of all these three representations is always the Tercera Caída. Okay? What's the difference? How is the Christ portrayed? Simple. The first Caída, you have one knee on the ground. First fall. And you have the Nazareno as an example. You notice the Nazareno has one knee on the ground and the other is up. In the second Caída or Segunda Caída, you have both knees on the ground. And on the Tercera Caída, you have the Christ on all floors, no? On all fours, lying flat on the ground. What we have in this house is a Segunda Caída. Because the Christ is just down on his buttocks. According to one of the daughters of the house, Pipit Revilius, she's not here with us, she's in the States now, they used to call that Tercera Caída, their tableau, which was imported from Spain. But one Agustinian priest, friend of this house, told her aunt, who is Telesfora Gorordo Garces, that's wrong, stop calling it Tercera Caída because the Christ is not yet down as in the third fall. So from that time on, they called it Segunda Caída upon the advice of that Spanish priest. So remember, Primera Caída, one knee down, Segunda Caída, two knees down, and Tercera Caída, all fours, knees and elbows on the ground. I'll show you some examples. This is the formerly Tercera Caída of the Gorordo House, now Ramon Aboites Foundation. If you notice, the Christ is seated or two knees down, no? About, and then holding the left hand on supporting the body. This used to have, this Caída, when it was imported from Spain in the 19th century, have an image of Simon of Cyrene. But Simon of Cyrene is usually represented only on the third Caída. So when the Agustinian priest told Senora Tiling that stop calling it Tercera Caída, it's wrong. So they removed the image of Simon of Cyrene. I don't know if the image is still here, but Pipit said they kept it. There's a slot in the carosa for the Simon of Cyrene. No? If you don't want it, I am most willing to take it. Okay, this is the Gorordo Caída. Now under the Ramon Aboites Foundation. No? And this is the Caída of my friend Ulay Tantoco from Malolos, Bulacan. So many people. Marili, this is similar to yours. There's a trumpeter. And then there is Simon of Cyrene. It is the most, the one of Binyang is also beautiful, no? Marili has a Tercera Caída. Okay. Those of you who have read my book, Handumanan, would identify that guy with the torotot. Okay, that's a standard Tercera Caída feature, which you don't find in the Primera or Segunda Caídas. Okay, the next one. This is an antique Caída of the Santa Cruz Parish pre-war. I think we lost this during World War II. And it has the most number of people. Look at the Christ. It's down, no? Christ is down, knees and elbows. And I've seen worse than this, when the Christ is really flat. The one of the Potenciano family in Binyang, for example, the Christ is 7 feet. And then the soldiers around him that are guarding him are 4 feet and 5 feet. And there's a reason for that. The emphasis is on the Christ, not on the Judíos. Okay, but of course, if you'll have one like that now. It's like a freak show. You have a 7-footer guy and being cruelly punished by 3-foot and 4-foot midgets, no? The same is true with the Last Supper I've seen in Paite. It's an old one. The Cristo is as big as me. And then the 12 apostles are about half the size of the Cristo, and it really looks weird. But it serves a purpose, because as I said, the pastors are Christocentric. And perhaps they carried it too far, or too literally, that you have to make Christ a giant and then make the supporting actors, which makes it ridiculous, half the size of the Christ. Okay? Okay, let's go to the lineup. This is what we have in the Cebu Metropolitan Cathedral for Holy Tuesday, or the famous Estacion General, or what we Cebuanos call the procession of the Luhod-Luhod. Those from the city can relate to this very well. This happens every Holy Tuesday. Okay, we start at 5 in the afternoon. We make 14 stops around the parish, and 14 luhod-luhod, because you kneel when the first invocation of, remember, we adore thee, O Christ, and we praise thee, because by the Holy Cross thou hast redeemed the world. We kneel in that, so we call it procession sa luhod-luhod. In Spanish it's called Estacion General. It's the last station, because Good Friday, Holy Week na. And this is our lineup. You have Saint Peter, the repentant Saint Peter, San Pedro Arrepentido in Spanish. Okay, always the first. And then it's followed by the Last Supper, followed by Saint Martha, image of Saint Martha. And then you have the Agony in the Garden, followed by Santa Veronica, that of the Casa. And then you have the arrest or the treachery of Judas, the one that I showed you earlier, followed by image of the new image of Santa Juana de Cusa. We have an additional image of a woman disciple this year at the cathedral. And then followed by the scourging at the pillar. After that, Saint Mary of James or Santa Maria Jacobe follows. And then you have Saint Salome. You have Saint Mary Magdalene, Saint John the Evangelist, the Sorrowful Mother or the Virgen Dolorosa, and finally the Segunda Caída of the house, no? One curious question, and I'm sure this is true for all the parishes here. Why is the image of the repentant Peter always takes the lead? Again, it's not historical. Remember, Peter fled with the other 10. It was only John who stayed with his master. So why do you think the image of the repentant Peter, I'm tired standing up. It's okay, can walk this way. Okay. Why is the image of Saint Peter, the repentant Peter, always takes the lead in a paso? Yes. Yes. Elise. Elise is the chairman of the worship committee of. I already called Elise. Repeat.
Because it embodies the true spirit of Lent, and that is repentance.
Yes. Because Saint Peter, the repentant Saint Peter, embodies the spirit of Lent, which is repentance. That is the reason why historically and biblically, Peter was not in the burial. As I said, he fled, diba? After he was threatened, although he remonstrated, but he fled anyway. It was only one, the youngest of the apostles that remained. And the women, the brave women. The church has always emphasized repentance. That's why, even if it's not historically correct, I'm glad we don't have the historically conscious father here, who would insist that maybe the parish will remove Saint Peter, I don't know. Peter is always, the repentant Peter embodies the spirit of Lent, what the church wants to do. So in both the Holy Tuesday procession in the cathedral and on Good Friday, it's always the repentant Peter. The cathedral has a very nice antique image, very expressive, no? It's owned by the Fulace family, and it's being taken care of now by the fourth generation of Fulaces. They never fail. Okay. For Good Friday, okay, these are some examples. Yeah. No, back. And I was the one who made this lineup. Because before, during the time of Father Sherwin there, I said, it's so boring. We have all the tableau, and then all they have the solitary pasos, no? They are also boring. So the time when Father Sherwin Ferrater was with us in the cathedral, I said, let's put some drama. Let's alternate the tableau with the solitary images, but do it in such a way that there would be a reason, a consonant reason for doing it. And I'll tell you, like what we did. Okay. The Last Supper is followed by Martha of Bethany. Any guess? Why should Martha follow in the Last Supper? Because Martha is the Lord's cook. Hindi ba? She preferred to cook than to listen to the sermon, for which she was mildly rebuked. She even asked the Lord, will you tell Mary to help me in the kitchen? And so what did the Lord say? You worry about many things, but only one thing is important. Mary has chosen the part. It will not be taken away from her. Sa ato papuyo, diha Martha, sabot sa imong gihimo. Okay, so she follows the Last Supper. Also because her image, her emblem is a basket of food. So there is a relationship between Martha and the Last Supper, right? Okay, if you want to follow this, follow. And then you have the agony in the garden. Why would Veronica follow the image or the tableau of agony in the garden? Because it was in the agony of the garden that Jesus first sweated blood, right? And what does Veronica carry? The veil that she used to wipe the blooded face of the Lord. Sakto? Okay. So you have the treachery or the betrayal of Judas, la traición de Judas. Why does Juana de Cusa follow her? Because one apostle betrayed him, but a woman disciple remained faithful to him. Saint Joan, wife of Chusa, was mentioned as one of those women in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 8, one of those women who, with Mary Magdalene, spent her own money for the movement. And she was again mentioned in chapter 24 of Luke as one of the women who went to the tomb early morning. So, gandang gid siya ni Luke. No? Luke named him, her. So, she follows the image of the betrayal because she remained faithful. So, what Judas did in the garden, Joanna of Chusa rectified by her faithfulness. And after that, you have the flagellation. We saw the image of the flagellation. 40 lashes, remember? Why would St. Mary of James of Santa Maria Jacobi follow that? Because the emblem of Santa Maria Jacobi is the Roman flagrum, the Roman whip that was used on Jesus. So, logically, she should follow this tableau. Right? Okay, and finally, you have the crowning of thorns. Okay, followed by the image or the paso of St. Mary Cleofe. The emblem of St. Mary Cleofe, at least in Cebu, is the crown of thorns. So because there was a crowning of thorns, St. Mary Cleofe, who is an aunt of the Lord, no? She's not just a woman disciple, she's an aunt. Because Clopas, according to St. Hegesippus, is the brother of St. Joseph. So Santa Maria, asawa ni Clopas, is an aunt of Jesus. And her emblem is the crown of thorns. And then, we already have the must have images of the Paso. You have St. Mary Magdalene, St. John the Evangelist, who took care of the Blessed Virgin. And finally, you have the Our Lady of Sorrows and the Segunda Caída, or the carrying of the cross. This is for any day from Palm Sunday up to Holy Thursday, if you wish. Next point. And then, okay, we have the images. Okay, that's Santa Maria Jacobi on the right. Her emblem is latigo, no? Bunal. And then you have the antique St. John the Baptist. I forgot the family that it's also antique. And then when I asked the owner, what happened to the eagle of St. John? It became an owl. And then they could not find a stuffed eagle. So St. John now is, and they said, anyway, St. John is the wisest and the owl is a symbol. Okay, so how can you argue with that? They could not find a stuffed eagle, so a stuffed owl. Okay, sige na lang. Stuffed owl, better than nothing. So St. John becomes Merlin the Magician. Not anymore St. John the Evangelist. Next. Okay, the Santa Maria Magdalena is owned by Senora Herondia Ralios, who was a very good friend of this house. Okay? Senora Herondia Ralios lived here and was often a visitor of Senora Telesfora Gurordo. They were such good friends. And the image is now under the care of the grandnephew. Is Lito here? From Abolo? Yeah, okay. The grandnephew is at the end, no? From Abolo Parish. But even if the camarero, Christopher Ralios, is already in Mabolo, he has remained faithful to bring it out in the cathedral. Otherwise, his grand aunt would haunt him for bringing the Paso out of the cathedral. And it has a sister Paso, that of Santa Marta. These are two Pasos owned by Senora Herondia Ralios, which is now under the care of Alito, Christopher Ralios, Mabolo, but they would still bring the Pasos here. Can you imagine such faithfulness? As I said, Senora Herondia, she has a picture here somewhere, was a very good friend and contemporary of Senora Telesfora Gurordo. They were not the original Paso owners. No? It also came from their ancestors back. Yeah. Third generation na sa mga Ralios. Na. And the left is an image of the Dolorosa of the Cathedral. It's fairly new. It's circa 19 after the war. I think the original image, the old one, was bombed out. And then this was commissioned after the war. It's a big image. And it's taken care of by the Chavez family of this area. Next, watch. Okay, for Good Friday, as I said, there is no more tablo except we don't have a Calvario in the cathedral, but we have a Pieta. The Pieta was made by Doña Perpetuana, I forgot the family name, in the 1950s. And from the time on until now, although it lives in La Hogue, where it has its own chapel, the grandniece or grandnephew of Señora Perpetuala brings it to the cathedral every Good Friday. So again, you still have St. Peter, as always, no? The repentant Peter, and then you have the Pieta, the only tableau we have for Good Friday in the cathedral. And then you have the women disciples. Look, how many are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six women disciples against one faithful apostle. So ladies, you're in good hands. Don't worry. And of course, the Santo Injero. Now when you talk about the Santo Injero in a Good Friday, that's now we hear the term calandra. Remember? We defined it earlier. You still remember what calandra is? Oh, nalimutan na. Calandra. Yeah, next. No, the next slide na lang. Okay, let's first talk about the Santo Sepulcro. No? It's of course the focus of attention on a Good Friday. That's why it's always placed in the last. That is the reason there. But if your parish priest, who is very progressive, believes that we should imitate how we bury the dead now, then put it in front, then kawawa ang mga santo sa luyo. Wala na yung mga uyo, which is what happened in Mandawi. Mandawi, Padre. Okay, and anybody from Mandawi here, aside from the Padre, who's not with the parish anyway? Yeah, I heard they just couldn't wait until the priest is changed, which is next year. They've been praying to St. Joseph, please remove him. Please remove him. He's destroying our religion. I'm very close to the people in Mandawi as well, no? Because I'm a devotee of St. Joseph, among others. And that's what they told me. They've been saying novenas to St. Joseph for the priest to disappear so that they could bring back their tradition. The Santo Sepulcro is always at the end. No? It's a human invention. Of course, if you want history, you will agree with the priest. But then again, you have to remove St. Peter. You have to remove so many things there because they were not there. History man ka. Okay? And then, they don't have Nicodemus. They don't have Joseph of Arimathea. So it cannot be historical. Unless you have a Calvario, I used to bring out my Calvario in during the time of Monsignor Tusing, may he rest in peace, and also during Tusing de la Serna in Guadalupe in the 90s, I have a Calvario in 4-foot scale, and I used to bring it out. It would take the lead after the repentant Peter on a Good Friday. But, you know, it's to be a camarero is not a joke. Let me warn those who are excited about owning this and owning that. It's not a joke, not only financially, but also physically. It is draining. I have about 30 Lenten Santos, and I'm about ready to give them up for adoption. I can see hands up the back. It's not easy. Maintaining them, and then mounting them on carrozas, renting carrozas. As I said, financially, it's not the issue. The issue is, it's really very tiring. And then bringing them back, wrapping them, storing them. Okay. Santo Sepulcro, the main attraction for Good Friday procession. No? In some parishes, I've been asked this question, so I'd like to answer it already. How many saints or how many images must we have? Well, if you're a new parish, like in Gindaruhan, Padre Tata, if you don't have images yet for Good Friday, to have a Santo Sepulcro and a Dolorosa is enough. For starters, you start with the mother and son. And then as the parish grows and more people get interested, you can start adding St. John the Evangelist and St. Mary Magdalene. And then that's four. You have a good lineup already for Good Friday procession. Okay? Next. So this is our Calandra and Santo Sepulcro at the Cebu Metropolitan Cathedral. You know, I have seen a 1929 photo of the original Calandra, which I understand was donated by Bishop Gurordo when he became Bishop of Cebu. It's from Spain. It's a three-geared thing. No flower needed because it's richly carved and gold leaf. And for yes, beautiful, beautiful. And the Santo Incero, which is still the same, is not covered in any cloth. I'm also against covering the Santo Incero. Why should we cover the price of our sins? Show it. Diba? But because we are good embroiderers here, so we invented putting a paño de funebre, as it is called, over the Santo Incero so that only the face is shown. I'm really against that practice. But anyway, it's culture, no? So until now, we cover the... This is a 7-foot image, by the way, from Spain also. And then the Calandra is now much downgraded. Very, very simple. The three-tiered Calandra of old was bombed during World War II. Next. This is in Lucban, Quezon. Look at the devotion of the people. Everybody wears white, men or women. Nobody wears any other color, no? Only the attendants, the one that mounted the Calandra. Notice, the Calandra has no decor whatsoever. No flower, not even a leaf. It's a man by the people. I don't know how they're called there. But it's also carried on a palanquin. No carroza, but a palanquin. Okay? I heard, you know, Lucban is at the foot of Mount Panahaw. And it's quite cool there. So I heard this procession begins at 6 p.m. and ends at around 2 or 3 a.m. Because it goes around the whole town, all the streets, no? Aron wala magmahay, tanang dalan, diyan. And then along the way, a lot of people would like to have a chance to carry the palanquin. And they drink lambanog along the way. It's cold there. I've been there so many times. So you can excuse them. But they do not quarrel. They do not... It's just that sometimes the pace is very slow because probably what? The people are already drunk. and you have to wait for replacement. So it comes in. The last time, I think it was 2 a.m. already, you know? But they say how they behave. Everybody is in white. By the way, in Lukban, even the women there drink lambanog because it's cold. It's really cold. It's at the foot of Mount Panahaw. It's a beautiful, beautiful town. So we have come now to the last few questions. I've been asked a lot of times about this. What is the appropriate decoration for a paso or for a paso del misterio? Flora, meaning flower, or fauna, meaning leaves? Okay, you can do both. Or you can do one or the other. In the cathedral, for example, we had a meeting that we would use all flower, all leaves, no? But come the day, I was the only one who used all leaves. And everybody put flowers. I said, what happened? And they said, the relatives donated this and that, and they have to put it in. Okay, so I said, fine. So I'm the only one whose carroza would not get mobbed by the crowd after, because I have no flowers. All leaves, technicolor leaves, beautifully arranged. And to my surprise, people started coming and asking for leaves. I said, what will you do? I have no flowers. And they said, we don't like the flowers. We use the leaves actually for healing. Okay, so my carroza was also stripped bare. So the next year after that, I had a combination of flowers and leaves, but more on leaves. Okay, just remember the basic rule, no? When we decorate our pasos, our carrozas, let us not overshadow with our flowers, because we are rich, we have relatives who send in flowers from all over the world, and you cover the image already. Because if you do that, well, you might as well join the Panagbenga in Baguio, because that's a flower festival. And there, every conceivable space is covered by flower. But that is not the idea, you see? That's another area where wealth, ostentatious display of wealth can be seen. The poor santo, who is supposed to be the object of devotion, is hardly visible, because the carroza or the andas is already full of flowers. Remember, Lent is a penitential season. So even your carroza should embody or should reflect the penitential nature of the procession, diba? Two things should guide us in decorating our carroza. Number one is good taste. Okay? Whatever is good taste, you define that for yourself. Just don't make sapaw the santo that you are decorating. Yun, the carroza is an art form in itself, especially the antique carrozas here, of this house, no? The Santa Veronica is more than 100 years old. The Paso de Segunda, Paso del Misterio de Segunda Caída is the same, more than 100 years old. You don't actually have to put so much flowers. Just, if you'll ask me, I'm in charge here. Heidi Alapar, who's in charge here, try to use more leaves in your carrozas, no? I mean, I don't mean to deprive our flower vendors their income, but it's Lent. And then, if you have so much budget for it anyway, why not give it to the poor? Diba? So you earn more merit than buying flowers just to show off your wealth and just to be, you know, to be praised as having the most beautiful carro. Then, as I said, go to Baguio. They have a Panagbenga festival there. And you can buy all the flowers you like. But during Lent, let's restrain our pride. Next. Okay, good question. I've been often asked this question. You know, when I was writing that book, Bantayan, I was with Dr. Versalles then. Good thing for Bantayan, they're so conscious of their history. They have an 1877 list of church property. And in the church property of Bantayan of 1877, the pasos are listed. And those that are owned privately are so indicated. In my recollection, there are only two pasos there that I privately own, noted in the 1877 inventory of Bantayan. The one of the Arsenas, which is Jesus Desmayo, and the one of the Saisons, which is Jesus Crucificado, or the crucifixion of Jesus. All the other passos that are not so noted, it's understood to be owned by the church, entrusted to the different families. Of course, the third or fourth generation of families now would never accept that. One of them is a bishop. Okay, so we just have to ride on with it. Bishop Do, the family of Bishop John Do, takes care of the Jesus de Paciencia. And they remain silent, but it's listed in the 1877 History of the Bantayan. But the biggest controversy there is the image of the Santo Sepulcro. By the way, the books, my two books are available here. Bantayan, if you want to have a vicarious experience, it's a very thorough book. And also Handumanan, if you want to know more about Visayan Santos, they're both available here and in USC Press. Anyway, the most controversial there in Bantayan is the Santo Entierro because it's listed in the inventario. So obviously, it's owned by the church. No? As I said, there are only two pasos there that are noted. The Dismayo, owned by the Arsenas, and the Crucificado, owned by the Saison. All the other images are assumed to be owned by the church, assigned to different families. There's one honest camarero there, my friend Chuck Arsenas, former vice president of PLDT. He's retired now, just like me. He said, "You know, you're right. Our father, our grandfather from Iloilo, the Arsenas family, original from Iloilo, were poor fisher folks that came to Bantayan, that became rich. So we could not possibly afford to have an image of Santa Maria Magdalena, which they have. Beautiful, beautiful image, no? He's the only one honest there. All the others would say, no, they'd invent all sorts of stories and they would fall, they would, you know, you can easily detect the lies that they peddle. Again, going back to the Santo Entierro, why is it controversial? Because the church wants it back. Because it's owned by the church. And the reason why the church wants it back is because that image earns hundreds of thousands of pesos every Good Friday. How? There is a practice in Bantayan that during the Good Friday procession, the big time fisher, you know, Bantayan is a fishing village, no? The big time fishing owners there, they would roll money in the hundreds of thousands and put it in a, wrap it in a white paper and then put it under the image of the Santo. So as much as half a million, okay? At the end of the procession, they would bring this out. They would take a few bills to be used in their business because that's the practice. I don't know how it started. Nobody would talk to me about it. And then they leave the bigger bulk of the money under the image. So naturally, the church wants to take it back because that money should belong to the church, and I agree. But the family who owns it says, but no, this is ours. This was created by this, by that, by that. And there are so many inconsistencies in the statement. I was talking to Dr. Versalles, and I said, you know, I don't want my book to be controversial. Let's just gloss over that fact. Okay? But the fact remains that it's listed in the inventory of Bantayan. Okay? But the family that takes care of it has, of course, taken good care of the image. It has an air-conditioned chapel. So you can imagine the money. It has an air-conditioned chapel. And it's really very old. So what the church did now in Bantayan, the parish in Bantayan, they have their own image made. But of course, it's not as popular as that one. Because imagine 1877. It was already there. It doesn't mean that it was carved in 1877. As of 1877, it was listed. Yeah, so it might have been earlier. Because the papal indult on the lifting of the abstinence in Bantayan is dated 1837. When Bantayan, for pastoral reasons, was allowed to eat meat on these days. Okay? That was for 10 years supposed to be. I've seen the rescript myself. My friend from Spain, Baby Pasi, translated it in Spanish. It was extended for another 10 years. So it was supposed to be only for a total of 20 years. So when I asked Cardinal Vidal about this, I said, Your Eminence, it's only good for 20 years. And he said, it has become a tradition. Let it be. Okay. So welcome to Bantayan. That's the reason there. Okay. So this is still true up till today. You know, the parish priest is not concerned with this mga image. That's why the parish buys, orders, but gives this to devout people. Eventually, the second or third generation of these people would start to claim ownership. That's usually the case, no? I'm not saying that there are no private-owned pasos. We have a good example of two here in this house. They have that imported paso from Spain in the Santa Veronica. I'm not sure if it's made, no? But usually, the parish buys, and then because it's a big distraction for the parish priest to take care of the images and all that, this usually assigned, okay? But now, there is a move towards private ownership, no? A new parish, for example, can ask devoted families, to, why don't you have it carved and take care of it yourself? So, it becomes a privately owned paso. But it is processed lang in the parish. One parish, somewhere in the south, the zeal of the people is too much that they have two images of the same sin. So what do we do? There are two agony in the garden, so probably you should have two scourging at the pillars and two crowning of thorns. The parish priest must stop this. It's the parish priest who is the chief leader. I always say this, we have parish priests in our group. You, parish priest, should put your foot down and strike them on the head, stupid. Why will you have two? Just because you want agony in the garden, there's already an existing agony in the garden, you want agony in the garden, why don't you transfer it, agony in the balcony or something? Okay, only the parish priest can do that. So that's how important the role of the parish priest is in running the parish. You cannot just say, it's okay, let's have five agony in the gardens or six dolorosas. No. That, you know, it has to be. If you want, there are so many other mysteries that are wanting anyway, especially in that particular parish. And why do you want to duplicate? Because you want to spite the owner of the original one. Because he kicked you out of circulation, so you want to come in. And then your agony in the garden is not even complete. You don't have an angel. So when I was asked, what should we do? I said, okay, for this, because the parish priest doesn't want to decide, I told the people involved, okay, this is what you do. Why don't you call the new one the acceptance of the divine will? So because you have a solo image of Jesus, a huge image looking up. And then the original, agony in the garden, the angel of the Lord consoles the Lord Jesus. So in effect, wala na yung agony in the garden nga title because it's now split into two sins, no? When there are so many other pasos that could have been made. See? You see what happens when the parish priest doesn't interfere. I heard in some parishes there is a Santa Susana. For God's sake, no, we are not Orthodox. The parish priest should say, you either change that to Santa Fotina or you get out of my procession. Simple as that. The parish priest has all the authority and the parish priest should exercise that authority. Otherwise, you'll have a heresy. Before you know it, you'll have the Iglesia ni Santa Susana. That's how it starts, diba? So cut it in the nip, change the Santa Susana to a more acceptable woman disciple. If you don't have Santa Juana de Cosa, maybe you want to have Santa Maria de Chipre, whose house was used for the Last Supper, or Santa Fotina, the Samaritan woman. There are other options. But there are just some people who are so stubborn, one step short of defying the parish priest. And no parish priest should agree to that. He should discipline these people. Mandawi was not able to do anything. What they're doing is just pray to St. Joseph to remove this parish priest. And St. Joseph obviously is working on that already. Okay, because na-disrupt ang tradition sa lungsod for no pastor just like now and then we would bury the body should come last. I mean, yes, right. But that was the first century. And things like those. Parish priest exercise your authority. Exorcise the demons among your parishioners. Do not let them start a heresy there. Okay. You know, as I said earlier, I'm about to give up my pasos. I've been having them for 30 or so years. Because it's not easy. It is my penance. Not only financially, but as I said, you know, physically, you have to help in bringing them out. Last year, I exhibited them. I don't know how many of you watched my Lenten exhibit last year at the Metropolitan Cathedral Museum. And it was a very tiring one-week setup. No? And then another, well, it's so easy to dismantle, but the setting up, because you have to take care, you arrange and everything. I'm about ready to give them all up, including the cross. Yeah, I can see some hands. What's your parish, ma'am? Oh, you have complete, di ba? Ano? Ah, okay.
We will select from
Virgen de Regla is asking for some. What do you have, your pasos, open, Virgen de Regla, what do you have?
We have
12 pasos? That's more than enough.
Yeah, that's more than enough.
Okay.
Because we're working for the Ascension,
the five sorrowful mysteries would be important. Talking about Lapu-Lapu. Yeah. Yes, the pasensya siya. There was a new parish there and the priest also didn't know any better. And the sculptor was the one who came to me because they ordered the 12 apostles. I said, during Lent, it should be only the 11 apostles because Matthias was not yet elected, right? Judah committed suicide, so there were 11 left. But then they said that, but there are 12 families who want each an apostle. Okay, for pastoral reasons, 12. There came a 13th family who insisted that they should also be given. And the priest said, why don't you have St. Paul? And so the sculptor was wondering, should St. Paul be there? So I told the sculptor, you tell whoever, the parish priest, whoever ordered you that, you are not doing it. Because he is misleading the people. St. Paul was converted long after this event happened. So can you imagine, just to accommodate a family, yeah, to satisfy, because probably a big donor or benefactor of the parish said, okay, you have a St. Paul. Of course not. I said, if he insists on that, I'm going to tell the cardinal. I'm going to put St. Paul there. Kumpleto sila sa women. They just want to have the male. Envy. Remember? If there is one vice or sin that we should take out this season, I would say start with envy. And be realistic. And you, Virgen de Regla parishioners, you are a very rich parish. Buy your pasos. Very well appointed. I'm giving my pasos to poor parishes. You're a rich parish. Bye. Okay. Where's your parish? Ah, oy, Recoletos parish. The angel of the parish has all the money in the world. What are your pasos? Do you have pasos? No. Only Good Friday. Ah, okay. So what do you have? Did you get the Dolorosa you wanted? Okay, but you don't have any tableau. You want to buy my Calvario tableau, including the carosa? Oh, anyway, next. So are we clear? Who owns the pasos? We are clear, huh? It's either the church or privately. But the ownership is not very much important. It's the caring that really matters. Okay? So now we have come to the last slide. It's just about right. What are the spiritual benefits of devotion to the passion and death of Jesus? You know, there's one very bad superstitious belief all over the country. They say that they don't want to have an image of a suffering Christ or a crying virgin because it brings bad luck. Can you imagine that? Associating the sacred images of the Passion of the Lord with good luck and bad luck. No? I heard from a priest somewhere that they have their pasos made, the parish, and then it was distributed to the different families. After the first year, the camarero of the Dolorosa returned the image and said, "We don't want this because our business went down." Can you imagine that? That is superstitious belief. And there is no basis for that. Actually, we can now have some benefits, no? Number one is that the images of the Passion constantly remind us how much God loves us, how much God, yesterday's gospel, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, so that those who believe in Him may not die but have eternal life. And having an image of the suffering Christ definitely fits the bill. Finally, if you want to be a paso owner, don't treat them as Barbie dolls. You overdress them. I'm addressing the young camareros here, especially those who are Q&A fans, putting triple tiaras. My God, you are defacing the santo. You think whoever that santo is represented by image would be happy? Putting earrings up to the shoulders. You know, putting Barbie hairs, putting layers and layers of cloth. Simple is best. And there is the internet. If you have problem designing the clothes, you can always Google it and find out how did women in the first century dress. And then you'll be guided accordingly. But when it's not Lent, do not treat your image as, you know, do not relegate your images to your warehouse. In Bantayan, for example, I've seen the piety of the people, very touching, especially those that have the tablo. After the procession, all the other collateral images in the tablo are stored. No? They're undressed, they're dismantled, but the image of the Christ has a special place in the house. I have seen this in the house of Mayor Iscario, si Nang Minjong, who was my neighbor here in Guadalupe, she rest in peace. They have a four-piece tablo of the carrying of the cross. You have Simon of Cyrene, two Roman soldiers, and the Cristo. All the others are dismantled, but the Cristo is brought to the sala where it has an urna for year-long veneration. The same is true with the house of Mrs. Fernandez, Daya. I heard the richest woman in Bantayan. She has the piercing of the side. So many characters. And all of those are brought to the bodega, except the Cristo, which has a chapel in her house. Always like that. No? The co-stars are kept, they're not important. But the images of the Christ they remain in the house. I've seen this so many. The Santa Marta, for example, of Harley Ruedas, the couturier, is from there. It has an urn. And another Iscario who owns the Santa Salome has a chapel for her Salome, because according to her, her mother was a Salome, her wife was a Salome, he named his daughter Salome. So there are four Salomes in his life, starting from the image. So he had a chapel of Saint Salome. Very touching. That is how it should be. I have to admit, I have 9 Christos. Only one is displayed. The others are wrapped in the warehouse. One of these days, I'll just raffle them off. Probably to the people who attended this, yeah, I see a lot of hands. It's not easy. It's a form of penance. Always a form of penance. Okay, so this is the last slide, I think. Yes, so thank you very much for spending some time with us. And we are now ready for whatever questions you might want to ask regarding the Paso. Wait lang. As a teaser, I am done with my research on St. Mary Magdalene. So whenever the second lecture series that we'll have here, let's talk about the saints, especially the controversial saints. Mary Magdalene was never a prostitute. Kay Sir siya, ha? Mary of Bethany is a Johnny come lately saint. Veronica is not the real name of that woman. If you want to know more about these things, watch out for Casa Gorondo's next announcement of the lecture series. Then you will really get to know them based on biblical and historical evidence. Not stories, not novels, not fictional, but based on research. Okay? I've done with Mary Magdalene. A few more months, I'll be done with all of these saints. It will still be for free. For free. Okay. So you're most welcome. Just watch for the announcement of Casa Gorondo. Yes, ma'am. Question. Burn the other one. Okay, ma'am, here is a very valid question. What would be a good criteria for keeping one of two images identical of the same one? The old one. The better looking one should be kept in the parish. This is your fault. No, the parish priest is in authority. Nobody should question the authority of the parish priest. If there are people who insist on duplicating an old one just because of whatever, the parish priest can sell it to the other parish. Neighboring parishes. That's why we live now. There are four parishes. In the Luhan is just beginning to become a parish. Diba? If that were my case, I'd give it to Tata. But you cannot have two. Do you have two in Kalkan? Ay, duha sa Kalkan? You have two identical in Kalkan? If that happens,